Welcome to Cultural Business and Entertainment. On this program, we're here to directly promote the relationship between two minority groups, blacks and Jews. And we're here with Dr. David Lazerson and Reverend Paul Chandler. Welcome to the program.
Thank you for having us.
Thanks for having us.
You gentlemen are with Project CURE, and can you talk a bit about what that program is all about?
CURE is a grassroots community organization operating in Crown Heights, although now we have a very extensive outreach program. But we initially came together after the summer of 91 and all the troubles that went on there, and we realized that there was a desperate need to communicate with each other. We always use the example, we were like ships passing in the night. And you kind of pick each other up on the radar, but there's no real interaction. What we found is that people knew very little about each other. And I mean both this in terms of Jews, their lack of knowledge about African Americans and Caribbean Americans, and blacks towards Jews. And at our very first meeting, that was very evident. And so what we realized was that that contributed, that lack of knowledge contributed to a lack of understanding, which really led to all those crazy stereotypes that just don't hold water once you bring people together and they meet each other and they see, hey, we're in Crown Heights, we're basically in the same boat together.
Crown Heights is kind of a buzzword for racial tension. Is there more tension in Crown Heights than other places in the city?
No, I don't think so. I think that something was played up after what took place in 91, but it's not.
And I was just going to add to that, Paul, that I think if, if anything, it, in my opinion, it's remarkable how well the two communities get along. A lot of people criticize what goes on in Crown Heights. In the meantime, they themselves are the ones who live in their isolated little ghettos. Crown Heights is is one of the few integrated communities that I know of.
I don't even think they live in ghettos. Actually, they don't even live in New York.
Mm-hmm.
Is your program designed to bring blacks and Jews together to form understanding?
Yeah, I mean, not only to form understanding, but to, bridge some gaps, as well as to begin to develop things that we can do together. I mean, we're both in the same community. We are under one God, one administration, and we're not going anywhere. And we want to help to thrive in our community and see our community grow and develop.
Do you feel like the blacks in Crown Heights view Jews as minorities the same as themselves?
Well, blacks are beginning to get away from seeing themselves as minorities. And I think Jews also, when we begin to see around the world, I used to think of the Hasidim as a minority group. And now that I see, in other cities that we've been able to visit, there's so many of them. We even have a brother who plays with our band, who's from South Africa, who's a Hasidic. So that term minority has been something, it was something that was put on all of us. If we look around the world, Africans, people of African descent make up, almost two-thirds of the world's population. And I think that the Jewish population is much bigger than what, they would want us to believe. There are a number of blacks who follow Judaism. So what are you saying when you say that? We're not a minority. People want us to believe that we're minorities, and then we begin to have a minority think about ourselves and an outlook. But I think as two people, I think we're bigger than what we're perceived. And I think if we perceive ourselves as small, say like a mouse, if you have that mouse concept, then you're going to run for a hole all the time. But if you begin to see yourself, that you're bigger than the mouse, then you begin to become more. Help me! Well, you're in control.
More
empowered.
Yeah,
but that word minority, it doesn't even sit well with me. And
so yeah, you have to be careful with words you use, because Paul's a reverend. He's always on my case about that, you know, and which is good, because a lot of our youth that we work with will come in with bum clothes or used clothing or damage, and he's always telling them, you know, what are you wearing that for? That's, you know, that's reflective of yourself, your self-esteem. And so I still say, I mean, I hear your point, you know, on in terms of more of a philosophical thing, but I still say that really in terms of this country is really kind of a white dominant European culture.
I'm not denying, you know? that still does exist culturally,
right.
and all the every aspect of life, but in terms of as in the world as a people, you know, we're not.
Mm-hmm.
So see, we do disagree. You see that?
Sorry, that's healthy.
How far does the partnership between blacks and Jews extend? Does it extend to business and marriage as well?
Well,
all right. thanks.
He's married.
He always gives me the doozies. Thanks a lot. I think that initially, when we came together to with Project Cure, and there's been a lot of key players. Richard Green from the Crown Heights Youth Collective. A gentleman by the name of Henry Rice, who now works for the National Conference of Christians and Jews. And each one of us kind of bringing in our youth from our respective communities and the circles that we work with. Initially, as I mentioned, we just had started with the dialogues until the youth themselves said, listen, we've met 3, 4, 5 times already, and we've been talking, and that's good, but it's not enough. If we want to have a positive community, we have to do something positive together. So I was, I said, well, what do you want to do? And they all, at that point, pretty much everyone said, play ball. So we went from there into the basketball, into a lot of multicultural programs. We did a joint Kwanzaa Hanukkah program. We had a model Seder. Right before Passover.
Created peace zones where we went and we painted basketball hoops and made them peace zones. Where
murals.
We've done a couple of art mural projects together. So there have been a number of activities that we've done together, which has, you know, by being involved together, we've been able to, you know, get a better understanding and be able, you know, we're able to foster a better relationship between both groups. To the point that now we were able to play at Madison Square Garden. We had a mixed team that played in halftime of the Knicks game. Knicks and some other team.
Philly, I think, was the game.
Yeah.
Yeah. And of course, we have our Black Jewish rap group. You know, that we've played all over. Just recently in Congress in Washington D.C. And in fact, we're playing at. What is it?
Lower East Side.
Right, Lower East Side Festival coming up in Manhattan. But, you know,
we
just
had a. I'd like to cut you off. A League of Neighbors concert in our community at Meg Evers College.
Unity concert.
A Unity concert. And we brought in some of the well-known cultural artists from the Jewish community, as well as Richie Havens. And we also performed. We recently were on the Roz Abrams show, we were on the Ed Bradley show, the Phil Donahue show, the Montel Williams show, a number of other shows, CBS, you know, the radio shows.
And now we're with Gary Mizell.
And now we're with Gary Mizell.
All right.
So we got a call.
We hope you get some big sponsors. You know, in answer to your previous question, like to what extent, we are. The fascinating thing that I find, one of the fascinating things of our whole experience together, we have gotten very close, in particular, Paul and myself.
You know, not intermarried.
Now the Torah says that's a no-no anyhow. But, I mean, he's cute and everything, but hey. we have gotten to the point in our relationship where not only can we joke around with each other, but we can be critical of each other. And to me, that's sort of that's more of a real relationship, as opposed to just smiling, shaking hands, and, you know, high peace, love, and happiness kind of thing. But what we're both about, and I think this is a real critical point, is that we're not about watering down anyone's culture. We're not about, like, let's sort of, here's a very strong, passionate, powerful Hasidic culture. Here's a strong, passionate, powerful, you know, African culture, and let's melt it down, and so we'll meet in the middle and kind of go like that. And that's not what it's about. What we have realized, what we work on, is that yes, we have our points that divide us. Yes, we have things that we disagree on. Paul is a Baptist minister. I'm a graduate of rabbinical school. Let me just finish one thing, okay? Because I'm on a roll, man.
I know, I see this. He's a preacher.
This is it. You know? I'm building up to this.
He's a real preacher, so, this guy.
So what we've come to do is to unite on those aspects that we can unite on. And there are far more aspects that many things that unite us than divide us.
Yeah, I heard a guy say that. When we first got started, the Rebbe actually said that there were more things that unite us, the African-American community and the Jewish community, than there are things that divide us. And through this, we've actually seen that they are. And we have a lot of things in common.
Have your activities been accepted by your respective communities?
Yes. And at first, I think that people are a little apprehensive about it. I think on both communities. I think the rap thing kind of broke down a lot of barriers, even with the younger kids in both communities, that now when we go down the street, you know, kids will run up to us and they say, oh, you're the rapping rabbi. You know, you hang out with the rapping rabbi.
Well, you know
you're
why.
You're the rapping preacher, you know. And
you know why?
Right.
Because I know what's been said.
Like a million times before.
But change don't come easy.
So you have to know the score.
You're looking for a friend
or a lifelong brother.
You can't judge a book by looking at the cover.
So, you know, it's fun doing that. I mean, you know, you have these guys, we're almost 50 years old, you know, we're doing this here.
Kind of even 40 years
old. Yeah, yeah. And we're doing these, you know, raps that the kids do. And the kids like it. But at the same time, we're able to meet people where they are. Not just with the rap, but with the message. You know, it's the message that we give. We were able to perform in front of 5,000 people in our community last summer, and they were all predominantly African American. And when we hit the stage, people said, "Oh God!" And I think we got up there, we might have started off something like, They might have done this thing. Yaseh shalom, yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu. Yaseh shalom. And then, like, then we break right into a rap, you know, and it's like, whoa.
See, Paul starts off with the Hebrew yaseh shalom, and then they thought, because, you know, that being a rabbi with a beard, I wear the black hat, you know, when we perform. So they thought I was going to give a little lecture about, you know, yes, brothers and sisters, we're all one family, a man type of thing, you know, that shtick. So instead I took the mic and I said, yo!
And then I say, oi!
And I say, yo! And then we kick in oy vey.
And then through the rap, we also give an understanding of both of our cultures and our history. You know, we talk about that. And I think that helps people to, with the hooks that we use, we hook them with that.
Reverend Chandler, I know you don't like the word minority from speaking to you during this conversation, but I want to ask you this question. African Americans are defined as minorities by the Small Business Administration, and they're able to receive 8A status to do special contracting with the government. How would you personally feel if Orthodox Jews tried to take advantage of the 8A program for themselves?
I think they should get it. I think... see, I mean, they're discriminated against because they're Orthodox Jews. I've heard some things said about the Orthodox community. I mean, they're really, by whites, you know, I wouldn't even want to repeat them, you know. So, and I know that they're constantly under attack. But I think in terms of, you know, whether they receive that kind of status, I say power to them, go get it. If you can get it, get it. you know. And, you know, the more we begin to share an understanding that these things can work for us, and then see some cases they work against us, you know, because then they lock us in to that minority status. Do you understand?
Dr. Laz, how do you feel about that issue?
I'm all for it. I mean, I as I mentioned before, you know, I think just in terms of, not in a qualitative sense like Paul was referring to, but in a quantitative sense, Jews are a minority. I think less than 1% of the population in the United States. It's not that way in New York City, but certainly Orthodox Jews and Hasidic Jews in particular, there are a lot of stereotypes out there about Jews. And then as the more sort of defined this Jewish group gets, the more there are negative stereotypes about it. That's one of the reasons why I mentioned before how that we both live in a country that is really sort of based on white European culture, and in that sense we both really are minorities. And this was really not my own theory, but a theory that actually I heard from Amiri Baraka when we were at Stony Brook together, who said that the reason why you find so much negative reporting about Crown Heights, and much of it is sort of what he termed subtle racism, sort of racism that people do that they're not even aware they're doing it, going into Crown Heights and just looking for the negative, in spite of the fact there's so many positive things that have gone on there. I've lived in Crown Heights 11 years. I never had a negative experience until the summer of 91. Now, supposedly, if this was a heatbed of racial tension, you know, why hadn't I experienced that living on a racially mixed block for 11 years? So when the papers reported that, you know, most of us in the community looked around and said, huh, where? You know, oh, behind me? Oh, is that where it is? You know, we questioned that. I'm not saying it was a perfect community, and it's not. But there, nonetheless, it was almost as if that they wanted to find negativity there. And what Amiri Baraka said, and I think it really has a grain of truth to it, that that there's this element of divide and conquer. You know, in other words, if we can keep blacks and Jews hating each other and against each other, some people are really happy about that. You know, can you imagine if we've seen that in our own lives now in the last 2 years, what we've been able to accomplish uniting has been remarkable. And, you know, on every level, really. So if we got our act together, the black community, the Jewish community, we could make, I think, some very serious and productive, meaningful changes in the country.
Dr. Laz, one of the things that distinguishes Orthodox Jews is the fact that they wear yarmulkes, and you're wearing a yarmulke now. Can you tell our viewers what a yarmulke means?
Sure. Well, let me just show the exhibit, because most of them don't. No, this is not my Bills yarmulke.
Oh, my God.
But this is, you know, most people don't wear the Yankees yarmulke. You know what I mean? This is like my team, you know, because when I grew up in Buffalo, it was Mickey Mantle and Roger Maris, you know, and Elston Howard, you know, these Yogi Berra, these guys. Okay. But let's get back to the yarmulkes. the basic gist of wearing the yarmulke is... It shows respect and belief in God and in the Almighty, that there is a being that is above us. In other words, and we put it on the highest part of our body, which is the head, which represents the intellect, and it's as if acknowledging that there are things beyond our intellect, and that God is above and beyond our intellectual capabilities. That doesn't mean we shouldn't study. Of course, we need to study. It's one of the commandments in the Torah to study. It says that you should know God, not just love God and fear God, but also to know God. But at the same time, we realize that as human beings, we have certain limitations. So it's sort of what I think personally, a lesson in humility.
Well, the more you know God, the more humble you become, and the more humility you develop and towards God. And that's how you really begin to respect God and serve God, you know. And we learn that, you know. He's learned in rabbinical school. I've learned you know, in seminary.
As ambassadors of goodwill, can you offer some insight to our viewers about how to get along with one another?
I look at it almost like a marriage. In developing a marriage, a relationship, you know, together, you have to know each other. And one of the best ways to do that is through communication. Prior to getting married, you know, we go to the marriage council to help us to begin to, you know, we think we know each other, but not until we, you know, really find another party to mediate, to help us to really, you know, flush out those things and begin to talk better and get a better understanding of each other. It helps the marriage. You find most marriages
get married that summertime
that work are those that people, when they do communicate. And I think that when people communicate, when they know each other better, they begin to respect each other, they begin to understand each other better, and then they can deal with each other better. They don't devalue each other, and they realize the value that each one has, that everyone has potential, that everyone is a creative force out here, that God has created us, and that we all, you know, we all want the same things, basically. When we first met, we were sitting on opposite sides of a table, in a circle. We never knew that we had so many things in common. We never knew that in terms of our past, there were so many similarities. We never knew that we liked so many of the same things. And as a result of the communication that we have together, we were able to build a bond together. And we've been traveling and doing so many things together that it's been great fun. And it's been a lesson. It's been a learning experience. So we share that, and we ask you to just try it. That's why we say he's the doctor. See, he's Dr. Laz and the cure. And see, he didn't tell you that. See, I'm the medicine. I'm the cure. I mean, that's what I'd say,
good,
Gary.
That's really good.
There's a kid that works with us now. He had attacked... he was involved in an incident where he attacked a Hasidic guy, you know, and they gave him community work to work with us. And he said, man, you know, I didn't even know we could talk with them. I didn't know we were allowed to even speak. You know, 18-year-old kid, young man, 18-year-old man. So I didn't even know we could even speak to them.
He left that first meeting, our first evening together, his eyes were about this big, and, you know, it. Like you said, he said, I didn't even know we were allowed to do this.
Yeah. So that's communication. And we broke that stereotype down in just one little meeting. And so he's going to carry that other places, you know. So now when he sees, you know, Hasidics coming out, he doesn't bug out. Yo, they're them freaks, you know, can't talk to them. You know, he's, what's happening? How you doing? You know.
Yeah, I just wanted to add to, you know, Paul's statement.
Can you add to that?
Yeah, because I don't know if that's possible. Certainly, maybe not time-wise, but we'll give it a go. You know, that I think that a lot of people are waiting for others to do it. They're waiting for the mayor to do something. They're waiting for the president to do something. They're waiting for a committee to do something, for the federation to do something. And my words to them would be, take the bull by the horns and do it yourself. Just get out there and do something to improve the communication, you know, to, you know, as Paul was stressing so much, is communication that leads to the understanding, leads to respect, which is really the logo of CURE, you know, C-U-R-E, and the E is for education. Organize a dialogue, bring in a speaker, bring in someone from a different culture, and that all leads to, we can teach tolerance, but tolerance is really, and in my opinion, is the lowest level, and it's a level that so many people, unfortunately, are not yet on. I mean, you look at what's going down in Bosnia, there is no tolerance there. It reminds me when I traveled to Cyprus, and I would pass a Turkish village, and then there'd be a UN station and a Greek village. And to me, the Turks and the Greeks, they both looked alike. And we'd go into the little villages, the kids would come out and play with us because we were long-haired Americans, you know. And, And we just left scratching our heads. Why are these people killing each other? Why are they going at each other? So tolerance is, in my opinion, is the lowest level. And sort of next one up from that would be respect. And then above and beyond that is really, I think, a bond of true friendship, of real appreciation, where you really learn from each other. As you probably well know, the Lubavitcher Rebbe has been saying for years now, and he's been catching a lot of flack about it, and most Lubavitchers do too, that, you know, he says that this messianic era is right around the corner. And, you know, what I tell people is one of the things that, you know, it says in the Torah that the time of Mashiach or the Messiah will be a time of peace for the whole world. So if that is indeed the case, let's make it work in our own backyard. You know, we can't just say it's going to happen globally, the sort of magic thing is going to sprinkle down from the sky, and we're all going to walk around patting each other on the back.
So it's time to get up.
Wake up. Right? Shake up.
Shake up.
Face a brand new day. It's time to wake up.
Shake up.
Get up.
Do it a better way.
It's time to wake up.
Get up. Thank you, Gary.
Thanks a lot. Increase the peace.
Thank you very much for sharing your comments with us. And I think what you do is fantastic, and that hopefully people will have a chance to see how you come across, how you relate to one another, and will be able to relate to each other in the same kind of way.
Thank you for having us, Gary. It's really fun.
Right. Yeah, thank you. We appreciate it and hope that this will be another step for us in terms of increasing the peace and, you know, getting the word out there that it's much more fun and a lot more productive to work out things together.
So we say to everybody, seek communication.
Across the nation.
Let's all sit down.
And have a conversation.
You.
Understanding.
You listen to me.
I listen to you.
We can work things out in harmony. R, respect each other's culture. Respect who you are. Respect each other's culture. And we'll all go far. E for education.
A point of elevation.
It keeps on going even after graduation. Bye, New York.